Okay, so I'm gonna continue this discussion about the vegans and the frugivores and the not the omnivores anymore. Omnivores are bears. If you think of a bear out there, a bear goes into the water and he takes his paw and he swipes that meat out of the water and eats it raw. That's a bear. He's an omnivore. Okay. So that's a difficult task, and I don't think humans really want that difficult task. I think we're more prone to this other. But I'm very excited about all these charts, because if you go through them, they detail like your intestine length, like we have like the same intestinal length as monkeys, and we have the same acidic properties, you know, so things digest correctly under those conditions, you know, because we have that same acidic intestinal grouping, and we don't digest, what is it? It's called cellulose. We don't digest this cellulose properly. It just is not, it's a non-digestible. I am just like walled out. There was a man there I just subscribed to, what is his name? And I don't know the name, it's Sweet Natural Living, I believe. But he's cracking me up, like in my mind, I am dying with laughter, because he eats so many bananas a day. He eats like 10 to 15 bananas every day. And then I found a lady there, and she eats like the same amount of bananas. And that's like their daily deal, is the bananas. And then in the morning, though, the Sweet Natural Living guy, you know, I really liked him because he's so determined in his process that he's true to it. You know what I mean? Some are flaky. They're not true of the frugivore. They will be frugivore just until like 4 o'clock, or, you know, not at dinner. No, they're gonna change their way. But they go back to being just regular vegan, you know. So things are not always raw. Yeah, so, but if you go back to frugivore all day, the Sweet Natural Living man, that's what he's doing at the moment. And he has like 1.5 kilos of nectarines in the morning. And then he has the 10 to 15 bananas. He's a mono-mealer. This is a new thing I've learned. Mono meal is just the one food at that meal. Okay, so as a mono mealer, he takes all of those bananas and he eats them, and then in the evening he has a bunch of papayas, mangoes, and then he'll have like 10 mangoes at one time, and then in the super evening, like for dinner, he has like small cucumbers or zucchinis, and then with avocado, and maybe during the day he'll have some coconut milk. But he really is a frugivore, like a real certified frugivore at the moment. You know, I don't know how long he can stay that way, but he's very thin. I mean, he's thin, and I'm thinking about the brain change. You know, the changes in the brain that happen through the diet, you know, the vegan self, our brain changes, you know, because we're definitely not the bear swipers anymore. We're not out there trying to swipe the fish out of the river. So it becomes like, what? No, just leave it there in the river. I'm not gonna go in there and swipe it. Just forget it, you know. That's the determined state of that hunter, you know, that wants to do that. And I believe the whole thing with the determined state of the hunter, you know, just goes back to quick. They think that they get that quick, you know, that power trip. But it's not. You don't get a quick power trip from eating all that food, do you? You get like, I mean, maybe it's a show-off thing also. It starts to look like a show-off thing. You know, big force, energy, you know, that man can go and swipe things out of rivers. and kill animals on the land. You know, maybe it's just a power. Like, look at me, I'm more competitive than you. I can do this, and you can't. You know, I can hunt and I can kill. Maybe that's the competition of man. You know, he just could not keep away from that succession of his self. You know, maybe that's what it's all about. You know, he couldn't just go and say, hey, you know, beautiful fruits, beautiful vegetables to eat. You know, he couldn't just do that. He had to keep going into this competition. Say, look, I can race faster than you. I can get up to that animal faster in the, as they're, you know, running around in the Maasai. They're running around to kill that animal or whatever. They're, you know, that's that competition mode, you know. Man is just eager for it, you know. So, unfortunately, you know, instead of just being eager for this, well, the fruit is there and it's beautiful. So anyways, I'm very excited by this man, that he is a dedicated to frugivore, because it's something very interesting. And I'm wondering about the monkey transcendental that just starts to flow through the brain. You know, are you having a transcendental meditation of a new self, a new type of person that is, oh my gosh, how do you live in this constructed world, you know, when they are all so plentiful as the hunter self, as this determined competition state, like I could just buy that type of meat even at the supermarket because I make more money, you know, I can buy that type of steak, you know, that is such a competition self, you know. So when we're coming away from that, you know, we're bringing ourselves off that competition line, what the heck to do, you know, because we really are passivated. You can say we're passivated by the food, but maybe the food itself, it just changes our mind, our brain pattern, our brain waves. It changes us in how we are communicating with others. You know, we're just not as aggressive, first of all. We're not as aggressive. I know a lot of people try to make me aggressive because I'm a loner. They try to make me aggressive specifically because I live by myself. I don't have any friends. You know, my marriage is somewhere. I don't know, but you know, when you have a what do you call it, a dual marriage, and you're isolated, you live isolated a lot of years, and then that person just drops away from you, I guess there's no getting back for me, you know, I'm just going to be isolated the rest of my life. But in those terminologies, it's okay, because I look at this group, you know, this group experience of world and people, whereas they are so mixed in and tangled in with each other that they can't, you know. So it gives me the outer bird view. So when I'm back to our brain and the thinking of the brain. No, and that's the thing, you know, I'm like, well, I really would like to try this frugivore thing. Gosh dang it, and I don't know how, because I have to, you know, feed another person. When you have to make food for the other person, it becomes difficult to have such an endeavor to say, hey, I'm gonna really go full diet on that, you know, because it's very intriguing to me. You know, to really, you know, be that primate self. Yeah, after reading all of the logistics of how our body is functioning inside, and the diagram of it, and how things flow through, and how things are not flowing through, you know, if you go that direction and eat all these meats, and you know, not only those words like carcinogenic show up, it's just acid. When you hear that word acid showing up, it just, you can see what it does to the cells inside your body, you know. and turns you into, and turns you into a cancer, you know, an easy cancer prey. So anyway, I don't know. I don't want to be like a lecturer or teacher here, but I'm thinking if you can be the primate diet, if you can go and really, really focus on something like that, that is fabulous. Because it's almost like a new awakening to your human body. Absolutely. So I have a feeling, you know, with me in particular, I'm just going to be a little fickle, and I'm just going to maybe raw vegan most of the time is the best I can do, but I don't know about frugivore all the time, you know, not like this man, you know, that was a sweet natural living, I believe, on the YouTube. I don't think I can do that. Anyway, yeah, 12 bananas, 15 bananas a day, and then the nectarines and the papayas. I don't know. It's, you know, where is the brain going? What is the brain thinking? You know, is he smarter? Is he wiser than he was before? You know, I'm all of those things, you know, I'm just curious about him, is in the experiment of that man, you know, because he's right now, he's a dedicated two, you know, the body and as that frugivore self, and that's just fabulous. Anyway, so apparently this man lives in Norway and then Costa Rica sometimes, so I don't know how he gets all of those bananas in Norway, but I guess they do. Very funny. Anyway, I haven't really been dancing today. I'm just not thinking about anything except, oh, another poetry book, that's right. I'm writing another book. Yeah, so I'm doing a lot of machine time with the photos. I mean, I have to make the photos beautiful for the book. And but yeah, and I don't know what to say about the angries that are out there. They'll have like the vegan get together, you know, they'll have like a raw vegan get together, and then they'll have this one person that just shows up and will eat like a bloody raw lamb heart or something, you know, in the middle of their meeting. And I'm like, what is going on? You know, why would that even occur? Why would that occur? Why would somebody be so possessed to do such a thing? You know, what is the cling to? You know, what is the fear factor of vegan? You know, I mean, do they have nightmares? You know, they're dreaming that they have to eat too many vegetables in their sleep? I don't understand. What is the fear that human being has? Yeah, apparently this has been showing up in another meeting. You know, they'll have their rallies, they get together, and then there's a... I'm sorry, I'm really hunchy lately, I know. It's just like my... I don't know. Very hunchy lately. But yeah, it's computer work, dang it. It really, really gets you. And lifting. Okay, so back to why are they feeling that aggressive towards vegan people? And then I read that they're trying to change the word vegan in the food source supply land and make it plant-based. And I don't trust the word plant-based because that means plant-based and then somebody will add something else on top. So don't trust plant-based. At all, I think that leaves it open for change. Vegan is pretty straightforward. It means no meat. It means no dairy. That's straightforward. And if you're the raw vegan, it means no cooked grains. That's really straightforward. That's the toughy thing for me with raw vegan is the cooked grains. because the grains have to be sprouted. You have to put them in water. And this includes rice. You can do this with rice, lentils, beans, any beans. You put them in the water, and then you rinse, you take the water out after 12, and then you rinse, and then you let them out, and then you put them back in, and you let them out again. So you get end up with all these sprouts. And then that becomes your grains. So you can eat raw vegan grains that way. But and I still believe that's frugivore. I still believe a raw vegan is a frugivore. But the raw vegans include, I know it gets complicated, the raw vegans include uncooked oil, uncooked vegetable oils, like the olive oil. So they include those. And frugivores really don't go with oils. So they get the oils directly from the nuts. They're not getting them from any other source. And that was what was weird with his diet. The sweet natural living man, he was not eating nuts. I did not see that. He just had the coconut. So there's a little strangeness there. I didn't see that he was going for almonds or cashews or none of that, walnuts, nothing. So that was a little strange, because I believe a frugivore really is supposed to have the nuts. Anyway, and these grains, like a seeded grain that is sprouted, you know, like a sprouted rice or sprouted wheat, sprouted, you know. Once everything is sprouted, you can even make bread from the sprouted wheats. You can make the manna breads. You can make the, what's that other one? Manna bread, that's it. It's with the carrots and the sprouted carrots and the sprouted wheats. That's really it. And they mix it all together. You mush it with your hands. I tried it once, and it I'm not a real good. I can't even find sprouted the hard wheats here to sprout. The stores don't sell them, so I'm looking in the wrong area. I'm gonna have to hunt for it. And I'm like, where's a vegan town? This maybe is not a vegan town that I'm in, so I'm having issues with just basic supplies like that, you know, the actual hard wheats, or the, you know, those just to sprout. So, or for barley, or for oats, you know, you buy those really tough little oats, the kernels. Yeah. So yeah, this whole food process, getting into raw, it's not really that tough. Once you're a vegan, you already know dairy, you already know meat. It's just the cooked grains. I saw a food pyramid today. It's just the cooked grains that are gonna be your big ta-da, you know. Because those are cooked in a lot of things, and those will keep the weight on. For sure, because you add them to cookies, you add cooked grains to all kinds of things, you know, any kind of flour. So, any hoot. Well, anyway, I'm excited to find a person that is like that, a true dedicated to the food supply direction. I just don't get the. These carnivore types that are so aggressive. I don't understand their melee. What's it all about? You know, why can't they just, why do they care? What is their threat? And then, I hate to say it, but there is the wit factor goes away when you have less fruits and vegetables, the wit factor in your brain. So it could very well be that they just are brainless, that they are living already in a dementia mode, that their brain can only function in a repeat. So they're very dangerous people when their brain is only in a repeat. It means they can't see new ways, they cannot change, they can't blocked, you know, just blocked. So it really is, it's like we're creating new groups of sectors of people. You know, we have the vegans, and then we have these omnivores. And we're like, oh, some of you vegans don't want anything to do with the omnivores. The omnivores don't want anything to do with the vegans. And it's becoming real rifty, like, ooh. Yeah. Anyway, try to keep the peace out there, but I don't know. I don't really have respect for the omnivores. I don't have respect for myself at any time in my life when I've eaten meat. So why would I have respect for them? So that's what it comes down to from the vegan standpoint of view. It's we just don't have respect for them because they're not trying, they're not changing out, they're just living the same old cycle, the same wheel. It's odd when the group, the hate group, is so hateful that they really are like these people who attack like the abortion clinics or something. You know, they're that hateful. To go to a rally and eat like raw meat right in front of everybody. I mean, we're talking total wackos. Anyway, yeah. So, I'm not really sure where this went today. I guess I just was talking about the amount of fruit and mono meals. And maybe we are more complicated as human beings, and not necessarily in a good way, when we add so many mixtures of foods in a meal. You know, we have so many different types of foods. It's almost like an attack. Attack on our brain. And maybe we are supposed to just that's it. You know, just eat a banana and just have banana thinking power for a while. You know, maybe over there just have your mango and have your mango thinking power. Maybe we're just not supposed to be taking our brain into the schizophrenia. I just ate a carrot and then I just ate a mango and then I just ate some coriander seeds and then I just had some kale and then I just had potato, and then I just had, you know, all mixed together. That's what I ate today. A lot of things all mixed together. And, maybe it's just not so brain friendly. I mean, it may look good on a nutrition stat standpoint, but maybe it's just too much. You know, maybe it's too many items. You know, for our, you know, maybe we're not getting the value out. Getting the value of that kale to the brain. We're not getting that value of the sweet potato to the brain. You know, it's just like, what? No, that other thing is there. You know, maybe this their carrot was there. You know, no, that was the potato. You know, maybe this it's happening like that. You know, we're just getting flogged down. And so we end up in a kind of a disassociated state. You know, I just add like, oh, I even put lentils in that soup a little bit too. Oh my gosh. And then I had some rice in there, a little bit. I mean, beautiful, and it tasted wonderful, but maybe it was just too many things. You know what I'm saying? So I'm just a wacko at the moment. Not as bad as that person or the people that go to these rallies, but yeah. Maybe it just makes me nuts. And everybody else in the same manner. You can go and look at simple foods like indigenous people. And they're very calm. They're very calm for the most part. And Mexican food, actually. Mexican food, original Mexican food, is very calm. It's just got the beans, it's got the rice. You know, it's very simple. But when you start adding all these other things, maybe it just gets too complicated. and you're not getting the benefit. Anyway, yeah, monomealing, it just sounds very interesting. Very interesting on the brain and what it does. The release factor.